Good morning. My name is João de Almeida. I'm the European Union Ambassador to the United States, and it's my pleasure and my honor to host you here this morning together with Europol. Madam Deputy Secretary, Excellencies, members of the law enforcement community, dear friends and colleagues, it is again an honor and a pleasure to open this seminar, Conference on Transatlantic Law Enforcement Cooperation, which the European Union delegation to the United States, in conjunction with Europol, is happy to organize here at the Knight Conference Center at the Newseum, one of the best views of Washington that you can find here. As we gather here this morning, our mood is somber in light of events in Boston yesterday. On behalf of the European Union, I express our sympathy to the scores of injured and to the friends and families of those who died so tragically. If one were needed, it is an unfortunate illustration of the challenges law enforcement and our societies face all the time, everywhere. And I think you will join me in dedicating this seminar to the memory of Martin Richard, an 8-year-old kid who was waiting on the finish line to hug his dad. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, as globalization intensifies, we have to recognize that crime has also become increasingly multinational, multifaceted, innovative, and disruptive, and not in a good way. The onus is on us, the European Union, the United States, public and law enforcement officials, to ensure that as we prepare to deepen our economic ties, that we adapt effectively to this transformation. I'm thinking of the forthcoming Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, a major project that will bring our economies closer together. As we do that, we also need to consider how to align our law enforcement resources to ensure that as we open up the opportunity for businesses and working families, we also keep criminal interests in check. At one time, this kind of negotiation would have involved only trade officials. But because so much commerce takes place today over the internet, because of cyber attacks, piracy, and intellectual property theft, there is increasingly an argument for a parallel law enforcement perspective, cooperation across the Atlantic. Europol is one of our most important instruments in this common endeavor. In its short life, Europol has come a long way. It is now fully a European Union agency. It functions today as a vital EU support center for law enforcement operations and a developing criminal information hub for our 27, very soon 28, national law enforcement bodies and international partners, and amongst them, the United States. I urge our American friends around this room today to use Europol fully, both to receive and share intelligence in our common fight against international crime in all its forms. That's why I'm very pleased to welcome today Director Rob Wainwright, who traveled from Europol headquarters in The Hague to be here with us today. I had the pleasure of hosting him for dinner last night, and we talked about all sorts of issues, and I looked at my brief, as I should do as a good ambassador, and I was impressed by the long list of operations that Europol has carried since Rob took the helm. It's been, these operations have spanned the globe. In line with what I just said about the new challenge we face at international level. On some occasions, they involved transatlantic cooperation with agencies here in the US and in Latin America, and involved a whole range of criminal activity, from credit card fraud to drugs to people smuggling and beyond. So it's very important that we were able to bring Europol leadership here to Washington so that in close cooperation with you, we move even further in our capacity to work together. This conference today will look at many tough issues. I hope will raise many questions that beg our serious consideration. As the day moves forward, I'll be looking with great interest to see what comes out of your discussions. I'll be ready to convey this to my Brussels authorities, and I'm sure everybody around the room will be also eager to see how much more we can do together. I'm sure we'll finish the day even better prepared to work more effectively together. In closing, I would just like to highlight that this event is part of what we call the EU Rendezvous series that we've launched some time ago here in Washington. These are sessions of debate and cooperation between Americans and Europeans, looking at the hard issues, looking at different areas of policy. Before this event, I remember a very important seminar last year on common security and defense policy with all the Pentagon community joining our own. I have a memory of my boss, Cathy Ashton, the European High Representative for Foreign Policy and Security, discussing here in Washington the hot issues of foreign policy today. As I remember the Vice President of the Commission, Joaquín Almunia, discussing economic competition policy matters here, and many more events before this one, and I hope many more in the future. And my invitation to you is that we will do this again in sometime in the future. As an illustration of the good cooperation that we have across the Atlantic, as a sign of how responsibly we take our role in fighting organized crime, all sorts of crime, and having in mind the multinational, international dimension of the threats that we are facing. So thank you very much again for coming this morning. I wish you a very productive discussion. And I would like to pass the floor to Frank Cilufo, who's our Master of Ceremonies today. He will tell you about how we're going to proceed, and he will introduce the keynote speakers that follow me. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, and thank you for hosting what is an incredible set of people talking on, obviously, an incredibly significant set of issues. I guess I'm the MC because I've rarely had an unspoken thought. But the one thing I do want to be able to do is yield 1 minute of my time, which is rare, if we could just take a moment of silence to remember the victims in Boston, to remember their families, and then we will get on with the program. Well, thank you. Walking into the Newseum today, anyone who walked in here would have seen the headline splashed across all the newspapers in the United States. Where I, in my office, I have a similar, back from 9/11 as a testament to the crisis at that time, photo of all the headlines from the Newseum, and unfortunately, yesterday underscores the importance of why everyone serves, why we have public servants who give up so much to be able to contribute, to be able to serve not only those, the men and women they lead in their departments and agencies, but ultimately the American people, those in the EU and elsewhere. So I think we need to underscore that, and sometimes we lose sight of the fact that these issues are real, They're not academic, and at the end of the day, they have real consequences. And if you look at the speakers today, it's incredible. It's a testament to just how much the United States, just to how much the European Union take this partnership. While undoubtedly we've had some disagreements along the way, I would argue that the ties that bond are a lot greater than those that fray. And I think, again, the events we saw unfold yesterday should be testament to that fact. I've got the privilege to introduce all of our keynote speakers as well as to moderate the various panels. A couple of ground rules. The keynote comments are on the record. The panel discussions are Chatham House rules. So they're meant to engage and foster a lively discussion. Not to say that the keynotes won't, but I just want to underscore that the panel discussions are Chatham House rules. So please abide by that. And as you could probably all understand, there have been some changes to the program. Understandably, Secretary Napolitano is focused on managing the crisis. She's the senior officer in charge for the President of the United States, along with the FBI, to ensure that the President and everyone else who needs to be well informed and having all the situational awareness on the issues, she's predisposed to do that. But we are absolutely delighted to have the Deputy Secretary, Jane Holl Lute, in her place. And Deputy Secretary Lute, I think, probably has one of the hardest, if not the most difficult job in the United States government. She, in essence, is the COO, the Chief Operating Officer of a department that comprises of 240,000 different men and women in the Department of Homeland Security. But I think perhaps the most significant role that the department plays is not just ensuring that the men and women in the department are fulfilling their mission, but also ensuring that their customers, that their partners at state and local law enforcement, at the private sector and elsewhere are doing their jobs. And as tragic as the incident was in Boston, I think it's fair to say that planning, training, exercising actually saved lives yesterday. The consequences could have been even more gruesome. And I think that's a testament to the department's mission and also to the department's leadership. So thank you, Madam Deputy Secretary. Deputy Secretary Lute, as you know, has a distinguished career in public service. She served in the Army. She served in the White House staff for President Bush, 41, George H.W. Bush, and also for President Clinton on a whole host of European affairs, which is apropos to today's conversation, but also Soviet affairs. And in between that stint, she was served in the United Nations, where she basically oversaw a whole host of different factors to be able to respond to disasters of all sorts. And I think came to the department with all the right tools. She has announced that she, after four very long years, will be stepping down in the near future. And I think we all owe her a debt of gratitude and thanks for her devotion, dedication, and I think real results in making this country more safe. So, Madam Deputy Secretary, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Frank. João, Rob, and Frank, let me thank you for allowing me to come and represent the Secretary, who very much wishes she could be here. Many of you have expressed your feelings of sympathy and solidarity for the victims, the families, and the officers at the state and local level and here in Washington who have been responding to this tragedy in Boston. And tragedy will not be a stranger to many of you. You've dealt with it yourselves in your countries, perhaps in your homes. And it's possible at times when you're following these things to lose track of an important reality. We're quickly impressed with the numbers. Several killed, dozens, many dozens, perhaps hundreds injured, many thousands displaced in some crises, not Boston, but others. And what we know is that despite those thousands, those hundreds, or those dozens, is that people like Morton die one at a time. They die one at a time. And so one at a time, we have to do what we can to ensure that these things are prevented, that we understand what gives rise to their occurrence, and that we join together. One at a time, we can make a difference. And all of you in this room have made that commitment. The events of Boston illustrate why our discussion today is so important, why the issues that you'll cover are not only salient for the communities of law enforcement in our countries, but also for the communities of citizens that we serve. Working together, we've already begun to see how we can transform the way in which we protect our nations and our citizens against the shared threats that we face, whether those threats are from terrorists, cyber criminals, or those who seek to steal intellectual property. And over the past 2 years, Homeland Security and Europol, in particular, have worked very closely to expand that partnership. The cooperation between our law enforcement agencies, governments, and our nations has never been stronger, and its impact has never been greater. We think, in Homeland Security, we think this is extremely important because we continue to see threats evolve, and evolving in a way that require nimble and flexible response by law enforcement partners around the world. Today, we face a threat environment where terrorism and violent extremism are neither constrained by international borders nor limited to a single ideology. We also face the increasing reach of transnational criminal organizations acting across continents as they seek to avoid wherever possible and whenever possible and however possible the rule of law. We're confronting the reality of homegrown threats in our countries, including individuals who may have no discernible connection to international terrorism, but nevertheless threaten our cities and our communities. Even in cyberspace, we confront a combination of known and unknown vulnerabilities exploited by adversaries with strong and rapidly expanding capabilities, so much so that many traditional crimes are now committed in or certainly eased by the speed and prevalence of the internet in our everyday lives. These conditions demand that we collaborate even more closely. In counterterrorism, we've worked to develop an approach to security built on an understanding that we need to identify threats earlier, allocate resources according to risk, because there will always be some risk, and develop a deeper and more sophisticated understanding of trends, relationships, tactics, indicators, warnings, based on what we are seeing in our own countries and globally. I can offer a few examples where we've seen this in practice. In 2009, Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab's attempt to bring down a U.S.-bound airliner on Christmas Day illustrated the worldwide gaps in the aviation security structure. He bought his ticket in one place, boarded a plane in another, transited a third, destined for a fourth. Any combination of four places on the planet would have been possible. The international dimensions of this plot underscore how a threat to any part of our system could put the entire system at risk. We mobilized collectively for action almost immediately. The Secretary deployed me and my colleagues in a trip to countries around the world who were committed to greater aviation security. Our first stop was in Europe. Soon after that trip, we held a series of dialogues, including with many of our partners represented in this room. And shortly after that, 190 member states of the International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO, unanimously supported a historic new declaration on aviation security that strengthened security by integrating intelligence sharing and analysis capabilities. What we needed fundamentally was better information sharing, better use of technology, better collaboration, including training, across the entire system. Supporting that need for stronger information exchanges, we also concluded a landmark agreement on passenger name record data sharing with the EU, I had the privilege of leading the American delegation in those discussions over 18 months, where my colleagues and I got to know every part of the European Union and its member countries, individually and collectively. As many of you know, PNR is an indispensable tool in our collective terrorism prevention efforts. Analysis of PNR data has aided nearly every high-profile U.S. terrorism investigation in recent years. But importantly, this agreement and our use of this data not only advances our understanding of potential terrorist plots, it also protects privacy, civil rights, and civil liberties, and enhances them through strong measures on data protection and retention. I can report to you, as I reported to my colleagues over the course of our negotiations for the PNR agreement, that over the last 10 years, more than 7 billion people have moved through TSA's security systems, more people than there are on the planet. And we have moved all of these people safely and without ever a single privacy incident. So we take these issues and we take the tools that we're given to deal with these issues seriously from the perspective not only of policymakers, from the perspective not only of regulators, but from the perspective of operators and of citizens who value our civil rights, civil liberty, and privacy every bit as much as any other citizen. We understand that the EU is developing data protection rules for law enforcement, including how law enforcement agencies share information with international partners, including those here in the United States. And we all have an interest in making sure that the critical transatlantic information sharing that is currently ongoing among law enforcement agencies is strengthened with these rules. We also have strengthened our cooperation in other ways. For example, we're participating in a new border management working group that Interpol recently established to better integrate law enforcement and border management and strengthen communication and information sharing among member states. And our preventing and combating serious crimes agreements, PCSEs, which we've signed with a number of members of the Visa Waiver Program, will allow us to exchange biographic and biometric information about criminals, further bolstering law enforcement cooperation. But perhaps nowhere is our partnership stronger than in our efforts to better understand and address threats from violent extremism. In both the United States and Europe, we've seen instances of homegrown violent extremism in recent years, from the Anders Breivik attack in Norway to several plots in the United States that have targeted faith communities, houses of worship, schools, and other places. We must increase our understanding of radicalization, its warning signs and potential indicators and ways to prevent such acts. We must break down the barriers that isolate communities within our broader societies. And we must strengthen the hand of law enforcement to prevent violent acts before they occur. For the past 2 years, Homeland Security and Europol have brought together law enforcement practitioners, most recently at the U.S. Institute of Peace here in Washington just a few weeks ago, to begin an operationally based dialogue in countering violent extremism that includes community-oriented policing, improved information sharing, and joint analytic work. We've learned ourselves and continue to learn from the 800,000 state and local law enforcement officers in this country. Homeland Security recently convened the chiefs of police from Newtown, Connecticut, from Aurora, Colorado, and from Minnesota, where we had, where local police dealt firsthand with active shooter scenarios. And we shared lessons, and they emphasized the importance of those lessons and sharing them as widely as possible across jurisdictions. We know that in some cases, the active shooter has gone from being a SWAT-based phenomenon to being a patrol-based phenomenon, and every officer must be ready and trained and understand how to respond and how to support response when it's necessary. Homeland Security and Europol collaborated on a joint case study of the Norway attacks, including an extensive analysis of the Breivik Manifesto and the attack itself, to better understand behaviors and indicators that may lead from radicalization to violence. We continue to produce and share joint reports, case studies, training materials that relate to countering violent extremism, to expand our understanding and extend it as broadly as possible to all law enforcement partners across the EU and across the United States. Two other areas where our continued collaboration is essential to the protection of our nations and our citizens are cyber threats and cyber crime. Cyberspace, something everybody's heard of, it's not something everybody completely understands, but what we know is that it transcends national boundaries. And in order to fight crime that occurs in cyberspace, we must have operational collaboration and a strategic dialogue among international partners. This collaboration includes cooperation with counterparts internationally to improve our ability to manage incidents and understand law enforcement cooperation under rules during steady state operations as well. For example, through the US-EU Working Group on Cybersecurity and Cybercrime, we've developed collaborative approaches to a wide range of cybersecurity and cybercrime issues. This working group conducted the first ever joint transatlantic tabletop exercise, Cyber Atlantic 2011 in Brussels, to evaluate our joint response capabilities and examine ways to enhance our cooperation going forward. We will also continue to fight child sex abuse through the Virtual Global Task Force, a multilateral effort that you'll be hearing more about today from Immigrations and Customs Enforcement Director John Morton. We continue to work together on Operation Rescue, an initiative designed to infiltrate websites and forums frequented by child sex offenders to identify and prosecute perpetrators. Homeland Security supports these and other joint initiatives through our Cybercrime Center, or C3, a state-of-the-art operation that offers cybercrime support, training, and forensic analysis to federal, state, local, and international partners. And Europol has been an important partner in this effort. We look forward to reciprocating that collaboration through Europol's European Cybercrime Center, in which ICE has agreed to participate. The Secret Service, for its part, has also signed a letter of intent with Europol to form a task force to be housed in the European Cybercrime Center focused on financial crimes and payment card fraud. This collaboration will build on the service's existing work with Europol and other EU partners to combat cybercrime, credit card fraud, currency counterfeiting, and other financial crimes which have produced several notable cases. For example, together with Italian and Bulgarian law enforcement agencies, the Secret Service investigated a criminal group involved in skimming credit cards that result in damages worth more than 50 million euros. Finally, a growing challenge that we all face is protecting against the theft of intellectual property. IP, we call it. IP theft not only harms lawful business and undercuts economies, but it can have serious consequences for public safety, especially when dangerous or counterfeit merchandise or medicines enter the supply chain. Homeland Security has been leading the National Intellectual Property Rights Coordination Center, a multi-agency effort that promotes sharing of information related to IP theft, joint initiatives, and coordinated enforcement actions, as well as investigations. Europol is a strong partner in this effort as well, along with 20 US agencies, including ICE and Customs and Border Protection, CBP. Our efforts through this center have been very successful at targeting individuals and transnational organizations. And to further these efforts, in February, the United States released its strategy on mitigating the theft of US trade secrets. Homeland Security will continue to act vigorously to support this strategy, especially in cases where trade secrets are targeted through illicit cyber activity. What does all of this work mean? All of this work means and reflects our shared commitment to combat threats that challenge our people, our societies, our shared systems of trade and travel, and our global economy. And while we have achieved much, we know that our work is not done. In some ways, it's just beginning, as threats evolve and our economies grow more intertwined. But we have a very solid foundation on which to build, and that's a testament to the partnerships that we've created, the many new capabilities we've put in place, and the exchange of information and best practice that has proven to be so beneficial to our efforts. So please let me thank you again for your partnership, for your solidarity, for your commitment to our shared efforts going forward. We appreciate in Homeland Security your steadfast support, and I wish you, and the Secretary wishes you, the very best for today's conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We now have, the privilege to introduce Rob Wainwright, who is the director of the European Union's law enforcement agency, Europol. Rob came to Europol from SOCA, the Serious Organized Crime Agency in the UK, where he ran international operations and ran the international department. Prior to that, he was at NCIS, UK's NCIS, the National Criminal Intelligence Service, where he also was responsible for international operations and coordinating efforts among and between various law enforcement agencies. And prior to that, he served in various roles in the British counterterrorism community. I'm delighted to have Rob with us here today. Europol is assuming a greater and more significant role every day, and Rob, thank you for making this possible, and the floor is yours, so thank you.
Thank you very much, Frank. Ambassador, thank you also for helping us to sponsor this event, and to all my friends and colleagues from both sides of the Atlantic and the law enforcement community, it's a pleasure to see you here today. And just to echo the words of Deputy Secretary Lute, it is indeed an honor and privilege to be here today, especially in light of the events yesterday in Boston, to be here as the Director of Europol and to represent the European law enforcement community and to make clear that we offer our deepest sympathies to the people affected by yesterday's events, and in particular, that we offer our steadfast commitment to continue to counter violent extremism and terrorism in strong partnership with the United States. Today's event, of course, is about developing that partnership even further, to build on the many common values and experiences that are shared between Europe and the United States. And whatever determination is finally made about the responsibility for yesterday's explosions in Boston, it's a sad reminder, as the ambassador told us, that we continue to face serious threats of violent extremism and terrorism and from a multitude of other serious criminal activity on both sides of the Atlantic. Last year in Europe, 17 people died from acts of terrorism, notably from two major incidents, a multiple gun attack by a lone gunman in Toulouse in France, and a remote-controlled bomb attack at Burgas Airport in Bulgaria. The year before, as Deputy Secretary Lute briefly reminded us, in Norway, 77 people died in one of the worst acts of violent extremism that we have ever seen from a single perpetrator in Europe. So in response to those incidents, and indeed many others, the EU and the United States over the last few years have built on already years of strong cooperation in fighting violent extremism and terrorism. We've stepped up our fight even further, and this includes a joint initiative between Europol and the Department of Homeland Security, as Deputy Secretary Lute mentioned, in which we have analyzed the phenomena of violent extremism and how that seems to be becoming an increasing concern for our societies on both sides of the Atlantic. Many other important counter-terrorist initiatives that are being developed under the framework of a very progressive partnership between the European Union and the United States. We share, therefore, a common bond, of course, and a set of cooperation instruments to allow the United States and the EU to fight extremism effectively. And, of course, it goes without saying that Europol stands ready to support the ongoing investigation following yesterday's incidents. Together, we also recognize that our governments, businesses, and societies are affected by many other serious criminal activities. And today, we will be hearing many more things about those, in particular in the field of cyberspace and elsewhere. What we're seeing in Europe is similar to the trends, to the problems that Deputy Secretary Lute was talking about. And let me spend a few minutes to give you an up-to-date European perspective on the serious crime threats that we face now. We see the emergence of a new criminal phenomena under the guise of a set of more dynamic, more entrepreneurial, more multinational organized crime groups operating in Europe. The new criminal problems that we face very often are linked, for example, to the current economic crisis and certainly to the internet. The economic crisis we've seen has brought European citizens into closer proximity with organized crime, as, for example, the growth of the shadow economy shows. In some respects, it's doubled in the space of the last 3 years as people's disposable income have decreased. IP theft and counterfeiting that the Deputy Secretary mentioned. Certainly, this is a burgeoning EU market worth at least $8 billion a year. And counterfeit goods, in particular, with an impact on health and safety products, is a major concern for us. This is going through an alarming growth rate at the moment. It is responsible, we think, for about 25% of the market share of all counterfeit goods in the European Union. Other forms of economic crime, especially fraud, have grown in scale and impact. Missing trader intra-community fraud, which derives from a manipulation of the VAT tax regime in Europe, is responsible for an estimated 100 billion euros in VAT loss each year. That's a lot of money to lose out of the public purse, this time in particular when governments are hard-pressed to reduce debt levels and secure an economic recovery. VAT fraud in the carbon credits market, now joined, we think, by organized crime syndicates targeting the gas and electricity markets recently deregulated in Europe. And also direct losses, meanwhile, caused by payment card fraud in the European Union reached 1.3 billion euros in 2011. And we are working very closely with the US Secret Service on this particular issue. So we have the risk, therefore, of a circle whereby economic downturn presents opportunities for organized crime groups while organized crime activity hampers economic recovery. On the internet, meanwhile, we all know that this enables organized crime groups to access a large pool of victims, to obscure their activities, and carry out a diverse range of criminal acts in a much shorter period of time and on a much larger scale than we've ever seen before. The spread of the internet and technological advances have caused significant shifts in crime areas and the pattern of criminal activity. Cybercrime, and in particular computer intrusions, network attacks and on banks, for example, and other critical infrastructure are now very strong threats to the security of the European Union as well as they are here in the United States. 71% of EU citizens regularly use the internet, so we're particularly exposed. Of these users, some 8% have experienced identity theft. 12% have suffered from some form of online fraud. Online child sexual exploitation, meanwhile, is another grim aspect of cybercrime. Individuals involved in the distribution of child abuse material make increasing use of technological advances offered by the internet, hidden services, anonymizers, and encryption devices in particular. Now, this will continue, we're sure, in the coming years as broadband speeds, in particular, increase and technology becomes ever more user-friendly to those involved in this field of activity. Distributed cloud computing will present new challenges, certainly, to the authorities in terms of digital evidence gathering and presentation, not just for cybercrime and online child sexual exploitation, but also for other forms of serious organized crime and terrorism. 30% of teenagers in the EU have had online contact with someone they've never faced before. And the whole field of activity on the internet involving such social activity, I think, is a growing threat. 2% of teenagers have been asked to talk about sexual acts with someone online. And the tactics used to engage children and young people in sexual activity online are increasingly aggressive and coercive and represents, I think, a major challenge to our societies. Of course, the EU and Europe are on the same page in addressing these challenges, and we'll be hearing a lot more about that in our cybercrime session later. Now, let me pause here a minute to emphasize on the essential point of today's discussion, of course. That is to highlight the common bonds and connections that we share between the United States and the EU. Of course, as we all know, security and prosperity is inextricably linked across the Atlantic between our two communities. And we both face a set of new challenges ranging from, of course, counterterrorism and addressing cybercrime and cybersecurity, but also managing, of course, the wider perspective of the economic recession and promoting job creation. The EU and the US, therefore, have few other comparable partners with whom they can cooperate at such an intensive level. We share the same values and determination to address these issues, of course. And what that means for our respective law enforcement communities, of course, is that we must anticipate this growing interdependency between our governments and societies. An interdependence which will continue to grow, for example, in the context of the future transatlantic free trade agreement. As our economic bonds grow deeper, we have to make sure that we protect the integrity of that economic cooperation and protect it from further exploitation by organized crime groups. The fight against organized crime has big implications for the EU's ability to secure an economic recovery. That's why the European Commission officials and Europol are now talking about developing a security agenda for growth to tackle organized crime as an integral part of our plan for economic recovery. And EU and US law enforcement cooperation, therefore, is also underpinning the global economic recovery. And we will continue to build on the work that we're doing in regard to countering fraud, in regard to IP thefts, and of course on cybercrime, to improve our response to the fight against these threats. All of these new developments, I think, are changing the nature of organized crime and indeed terrorism. It requires a new approach. Globalization has certainly had a major impact. We recently published our major strategic assessment of the threat from serious and organized crime. This is the definitive assessment in the EU, allowing our ministers to establish the strategic priorities for the fight against serious and organized crime for the next 4 years. This shows that there is a new breed of organized crime emerging now in Europe, as I said earlier, more dynamic and entrepreneurial. We've identified 3,600 internationally active organized crime groups in Europe. They are much more multinational than ever before. We have some groups with over 60 nationalities amongst their membership. They're certainly operating in many more jurisdictions, in many more criminal sectors simultaneously than they have done before. So the emergence of a new internationally networked set of organized crime groups. So we need to update our methods to match these new threats, therefore, and to globalize our response. And that's why at the cornerstone of the European response to globalized crime is information sharing, and at the cornerstone of that is the establishment of Europol as an intelligence-led organization that allows the EU member states to share information and to use that information to effectively combat the threats involved. To use a US language, we are a fusion center. 800 law enforcement officials from every member state in the European Union working together in our headquarters in The Hague, pooling massive amounts of criminal data under very high standards of data protection and data security. And from that, aggregating uniquely in one place a European centralized database of organized crime and terrorist activity. And from that and the analysis of that information on a daily basis, we were able to identify new leads for international investigation across Europe and indeed beyond. Amongst our staff are 150 dedicated operational officers acting in a liaison capacity on behalf of their agencies in the member states and increasingly from other countries, including the United States. So uniquely an operational center at the heart of the response to organized crime in Europe. Between them, they are coordinating 15,000 major cross-border investigations each year. Amongst our capabilities in Europe are dedicated centers to fight the worst forms of organized crime activity. the most recent of which is the innovation by which we have established the European Cybercrime Centre, a major initiative which embodies, I think, the European Union's new international response to fighting organised crime. It is the information hub for cybercrime in Europe and will become a dedicated centre of expertise in the fight against all forms of cybercrime offences. So I believe Europol is a very powerful tool and that we're making a real difference to the investigations involved. But of course, we must do our work not only in Europe, but across the world and with our global partners, none of which are more important than those here in the United States. We have an increasing engagement with the US authorities. We have 7 federal agencies that are represented in our headquarters, and we have 4 more that we're currently negotiating with in terms of establishing a liaison office also. And this tells you already, therefore, about the extensive cooperation that we have in all fields of serious crime and terrorism and across many sectors of the US law enforcement community. In the last 12 months, Europol has supported 50 high-impact international investigations in which the United States was involved. That's a record number, and it's growing all the time. 40 of those major operations are still ongoing. This includes, for example, an excellent partnership that we have with ICE on online child sexual exploitation, a number of operation successes in the last couple of years. And I would like to thank Director John Morton in particular for his leadership of that agency, for the fine example that he sets in terms of international cooperation, and for the work of all of his officers in those important operations. We're also engaged in, I think, very promising work on IP thefts with ICE, with other agencies as well, working within the framework of the new IPR Center, which Deputy Secretary Lute mentioned. We're working with the FBI on terrorism, on cyber, something that I reviewed with Deputy Director Joyce yesterday. Working with the DEA on a whole range of important international investigations against the growing threat of drug trafficking, where some important novelties are happening. The Department of Treasury on terrorism financing, and recently on asset freezing of transnational organized crime networks. I mentioned already our important project with the Department of Homeland Security on countering violent extremism, and I'm looking forward to further cooperation with a number of other US agencies. In conclusion, therefore, we are seeing with the emergence of a new criminal phenomena, many linked to the current economic crisis, to the internet, a changing nature of organized crime towards a model based upon a network community of heterogeneous international groups becoming more dynamic and powerful in their intersection with the legal economy, in the way in which they affect directly millions of our citizens on both sides of the Atlantic. We see the economic crisis affecting the ability of organized crime to respond, meanwhile giving new, unique opportunities to organized crime to make illicit profits. This calls for a much more international response. It calls for the law enforcement communities on both sides of the Atlantic to build on the excellent work that we've done over many years and to make an even more secure, even stronger partnership in the future. One based on effective bilateral cooperation between the United States and European Union member states, but also increasingly in terms of the ability for the US and the EU to operate at a multinational level as we face a multinational threat in the way that we do. Ambassador, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for this event today. Thank you for coming. And thank you, most importantly, to the US law enforcement community for the excellent work that we are engaged in fighting these important threats. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Wainwright. I think you provided a ton of grist for the mill for what we hope to pick up in the panel discussion later on. And I might note that while the nature of crime, as terrorism and other forms of violence, changed, human nature remains the same. So sometimes a good cop is a good cop, and a good investigator is a good investigator. We just need to ensure that they've got the tools, the modern tools, to get their jobs done. So I'm excited for the discussion later on along those lines. I now have the privilege to introduce the Director of U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, John Morton. I think ICE, as it's better known in the United States, is an agency that has a huge mission much of which I'm not sure everyone is fully familiar with, whether it's IP enforcement, whether it's protecting our youth from child exploitation. The mission area is broad. It is the principal investigative enforcement agency for the Department of Homeland Security, and it's the second largest in the United States. If I'm not mistaken, it's got approximately 20,000 people, and John oversees that. And I might also note that he was confirmed unanimously, given the tense set of issues they have, that's a very strong testament to his background. John came to ICE from the Department of Justice, where he served in various capacities, including as an AUSA, an assistant U.S. attorney. He was also counsel to the Deputy Attorney General, and perhaps the most storied of all Department of Justice offices, he was acting Deputy Assistant Attorney General of the Criminal Division. And John, we're delighted you're here with us today. I think your agency has a huge international footprint that most people aren't aware of as well, and thank you for taking the time.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. It is true that I was confirmed by the Senate 100-0, I think 4 years later, with all of the issues that I've had to face and the decisions I've had to make. I'm not sure I'd get the same count if I had to do it over again. But I am the director of ICE, and ICE does have a very broad mission, much of which is poorly understood because part of what we do, actually less than half of what we do, immigration enforcement, is such a hot and unsettled issue in this country. But we have just about 7,000 special agents in the agency focused on criminal investigations of all kind, and by our very nature, we're focused on transnational crime, which leads us overseas and leads us to the need for very, very serious partnerships, and that's why we have a very significant overseas presence. We're in 49 countries around the world, and we're about to be in our 50th. And it's a huge part of what we do, and it's a necessary part of what we do. I am not going to follow my prepared remarks, which is much to my staff's dismay, but it's a common habit that I have, and it's unbreakable at this point, 4 years in. And so I'm really just going to try to bring some real focus and real terms to why I think cooperation is critical between the United States and the European Union. I will start by saying I don't think you have to look much farther than me for an example of why cooperation makes a lot of sense. Some of you know, but most of you probably don't know, my actual first allegiance when I was born was to Her Majesty. I was born in the United Kingdom. My mother is not an American. My mother is a Brit. I was born in Scotland and spent the first part of my life there and am a citizen by birth and right of another country. I also happen to be an American. My dad was born in Charlottesville, and it's one of the great strengths, I think, of the United States that somebody with my background can be the head of Immigration and Customs Enforcement. My mother remains an immigrant to this day. She's has spent her entire life in the United States, has never naturalized, and will probably go to her grave as a UK citizen. And I'm a huge, huge believer in the cooperation between the European Union and the United States. Frankly, I think it's necessary. We'll talk about that in a second. I think it's necessary almost at an existential level. There's just no other way to do it. I also want to thank everybody here because I see a lot of familiar faces in the room, and oftentimes you come and you listen to us drone on, and really we're preaching to the converted in many respects. And let me just take a moment to note that the reason that we're here, which is to talk about cooperation in the law enforcement setting, is that's a worthy topic. I mean, law enforcement, at the end of the day, is an extremely honorable cause. It is a great privilege, I think, for those of us who are involved in it to be involved in it. And lots of people jump up and down about law enforcement. There's all sorts of conspiracy theories left and right, but at the end of the day, we are necessary in a very, very honorable and thoughtful way. And for all of you who are either in law enforcement or got your start in law enforcement or have supported law enforcement, my personal thanks to you for what you've done, what you do, what you support. Our ties are growing between the U.S. and the EU, and I take some satisfaction in ICE being at the forefront there. We have the very first law enforcement attaché to the EU that we just put in Brussels at vast expense. And we have, at a similarly vast expense, assigned agents to the European Cybercrime Center. We run the Cybercrime Center in the United States, and we were there when the director initiated EC3, and with great pride to represent the United States, and we've assigned officers there. And Europol, as the Deputy Secretary has mentioned, is one of the founding international members of the IPR Center right across the river, which ICE also runs, and Lev Kubiak, the director, is here, and I'm extremely grateful for that. Now, the expense is so great that, particularly in this time of sequester, it's been a challenge for us. We've had to take nearly $400 million in cuts. Fortunately, Rob was very generous last night over a couple of drinks of wine, and he's agreed to lend me 250 million euros at no cost for a year out of Europol's budget. And I'm looking for some Russian imperial bonds that I can pay him back in. I want to give some real-world examples of why I think we have got to focus on this cooperation and just go at it hammer and tong. And listen, I recognize the need for privacy protection. I am a huge supporter, but I think we have to have real balance, and we've got to have strong and speedy exchange of information and strong relationships, because at the end of the day, we are dealing with a committed foe who has no respect whatsoever for boundaries or our traditional concepts of sovereignty. And if we're going to have a meaningful effect in deterring organized crime, I think we've got to change the way we're doing business. We've got to focus on innovation, much more joint activity. We've got to move from the concept of basic cooperation and coordination to truly joint investigative activity, where it is routine that I assign agents to the director, Europol assigns agents to us, and that we are working together in a way that the boundary, the border, is not an impediment to good law enforcement. I mean, some of the things that we're going to be talking about today, you know, IP and child exploitation, for example, I mean, just think about the consequences for our society. When it comes to child exploitation, you know, the consequences to our youth, the scale of what is going on, the depth of the depravity that is occurring. These are awful, terrible harms that have a lasting consequence. We're talking about a child, largely, that is marked for life. And the initial investigation and arrest of the perpetrator is just the beginning, not the end. It is the beginning. And then there is a whole need for a therapeutic response to try to restore an individual who's been harmed. Typically a very innocent younger person, to restore that harm, to restore that person to a place where they can be a meaningful participant in our society. And intellectual property theft is something that is now occurring in the billions, and I think we ignore the challenges at our peril. The internet has absolutely changed the game. There are so many offenses that used to take place at the corner of 4th and Main that now occur almost entirely online. Child exploitation, child pornography, almost completely online, and in a way that we no longer investigate a group of child pornographers in a given state. I mean, we are talking about criminal communities that form themselves around criminal activity as opposed to geography. In every major international child exploitation case we investigate now that involves the internet, we're not looking for a core central location of that criminal activity somewhere in some country. It's not defined that way. It is defined literally in terms of the internet, in terms of servers here, there, and everywhere in exchange, and you literally have criminals from 15 different countries watching live child exploitation online at the same time around the world. That's the kind of challenge that we have to look at and address. And I think one of the challenges for us, quite frankly, is that we're going to have to deal with an attitude in certain parts of our society that somehow thinks that the internet, the rules of the internet, should be different. And we're struggling as societies with what are the rules of the road for the internet. And things that we can all agree are a crime and should be investigated fully at the corner of 4th and Main, when you move that exact same crime to the internet, the reaction to how government should go about investigating that and prosecuting that exact same crime are different. And we have to ask ourselves why. And my own view is the internet is one of the great innovations of our time and something that should be thoroughly supported. But just like we need interstate highways and we need an internet to promote innovation and advance and growth, you got to have rules. And it can't be an area of lawlessness, because then you have terrible abuse and exploitation. All right, why don't we just move quickly here to a few slides, and I just want to highlight for all of you that, one, that the cooperation is ongoing, but also what a big challenge we face and why real active joint cooperation is critical. So this picture that you're looking at right now is a photograph that we came across in Boston in November of 2010. And it is a picture of a two-year-old child holding a stuffed toy. And we received this, we searched a gentleman's home in Boston. He was a target of one of our child pornography investigations, and we came across this image and a series of images. And we analyzed it, and we ultimately determined that although the child depicted had Caucasian features, we didn't think the background was a U.S. background. And so we took that photograph, again in November of 2010, and we went to Europe. And we exchanged this photograph with our European law enforcement partners. And in short order, the Dutch National Police and the Dutch National Policeman recognized not the child in this photograph, but the stuffed toy as being particular to that part of the world. And it's actually a stuffed rabbit. And recognized and said, you know what, this toy is so unique that this is going to be a Dutch child. And we then, working with the Dutch National Police, had a one-time airing on television, on Dutch National TV, of the actual photo without blurring. And in short order, the relatives of the child were watching the show and called the police. And the perpetrator was watching the same show and ran home and started to erase all of his computer media. Within a few hours of the airing of that photograph, the Dutch National Police were able to learn who the perpetrator was, go find him. And he turned out to be a man named Mikkelsens, who worked at a daycare center. And had been abusing children for quite some time, the youngest of whom was 19 days old. And he had abused over 80 children using his position as a daycare provider at the local daycare. What was interesting about this is we used this photograph in less than a month working with European law enforcement officials to stop the worst case of child abuse that had ever happened, that the Dutch National Police had ever investigated. They turned around and, working with us, seized all of his computers, and he had attempted to destroy all of the records, but we were able to recover them. And those, in turn, led us back to the United States and throughout Europe, and we uncovered a whole network of child pornographers exchanging information and videos. And at last count, we had arrested 16 people in the United States and 35 people primarily in Europe, all around this particular case, all coming from the photograph that you see there. And that's an example of where something that started in the United States went to Europe and then came back. And just, this isn't, that photograph is started in the United States, but it's not about a U.S. case. It's not really even about a European case, even though the child depicted is Dutch. This was a case of international child exploitation occurring over the web in a grand scale. So the next thing we're going to go to here is the reverse, where Danish police were online in a chat room, and there was a series of postings from a 16-year-old girl talking about how he wanted some advice because he was planning to rape an 11-year-old that he knew in his town. And he was soliciting advice on a site for pedophiles on how to go about doing it. And the Danes had figured out that this was most likely a communication from the United States. And they had a series of images. And the image you see on the screen is one of the images they sent us. Right? So we had no idea who the 17-year-old was, didn't know his name. We just knew that he was soliciting advice, and then we had a few images that he had posted as part of his solicitation. And this is one of them. And what it is a picture of a road sign taken out of a window of a car as it's going by, but it's blurred. And what it depicts is a road sign with a sunflower image, but the numbers were too blurred to tell what it is. So we used sort of sophisticated computer techniques to try to enhance the photograph, and we were able to figure out that the sign depicted is unique to the state of Kansas, and the state of Kansas has a sunflower sign for their highway road signs, but we still couldn't tell what the number was. So we took that photograph that we got from the Danes, we got agents, and we went up and down every highway in Kansas until we found that exact sign, which is this sign. And once we located the actual sign, we then went to the local sheriff's department, and with some of the other photographs, we were able to figure out where a particular swimming pool was that this girl frequented. We were able to get, figure out who the girl was, get to the family, figure out who the perpetrator was, and we were able to stop the rape before it ever occurred, all in the space of 2 weeks. Just tremendous, tremendous work to prevent a terrible wrong from happening, and it was all done in short order because of great U.S.-EU cooperation. And if we had had to go through 5 months of bureaucratic exchanges and letters and this and that, guess what? There would have been a very, very bad result for the girl in question, who was 11 years old. And that's what we've all got to keep in mind. Again, the government is about balance, but there's an important balance in the form of protecting our citizens and being able to move and cooperate with each other with some speed when it's called for. And this is a particularly good example. We then took that whole effort that we received from the Danes and turned that into a major initiative where we went after people who are doing this kind of things. And in the space of 5 weeks, we arrested 245 people. We rescued 113 children, 44 of whom were living with their abuser at the time that we arrested them. So this is serious business with real harm to real people and why we've got to take it so seriously. All right, then moving on, and then you see at the bottom, there are some of, we went to the public and we said, we need your help to identify some of these perpetrators. We had some video clips, we had some pictures, and we had just run every lead and we couldn't go any further. And we try not to re-victimize victims, but sometimes you have to go to the public and get help, and we did. And I will tell you, almost we've had extraordinarily good success when we go to the public with these pictures and say, help us find this person. And we found them almost every time. All right. And then very briefly, because I know we've got lots to do today, I want to put in, again, a plug just for this basic sense of cooperation on the intellectual property side of things. We run the IPR Center. It's been a wild success. I'll tell you, it wasn't a wild success the first time we tried it. This is the second time we tried to do this. But thanks to now our partner agencies from around the United States and now around the country, we have Europol, we have Interpol, I mean around the world, we have Europol, Interpol, Canada, and Mexico. It really is a great success. And we've been seizing websites. This is the banner that we put on our website, on the websites that we seize. Europol has been helping us do the exact same thing and seize infringing websites that are based out of Europe. And here's why we need to do this, and getting back to why the internet has literally changed the game. You have an example here of two websites. One is the legitimate website for Rosetta Stone, which, as most of the Americans in the room will know, provides language training, and actually started in Virginia, right across the river. Great American business success story. They don't produce Rosetta Stone anywhere other than the United States. And you have opposite it a counterfeit copycat website. And look at how the trouble that the criminals are going to now to dupe the consumer. There's no pretense of being a knockoff site. There's no pretense of trying to sell something at 50 cents on the dollar. They are trying to be Rosetta Stone, and they are trying to drive all the traffic they can to their site so that the person involved never knows that they are buying a counterfeit. And we see this all of the time, and it's one of the reasons why we've been doing so much work in Europe, because we're now talking about large corporations. We do a lot of work with Louis Vuitton, for example, and they face all sorts of copycat sites like this. And it's an example of why this isn't a problem that can be readily reduced to simple arguments about Hollywood versus Google. That is just not what's going on, and this is a major, major issue for our country, for our economies, for the way we as civilized nations interact. And just to highlight that, and this will be the last thing that I really raise with you, I want to show you a video that that brings home the point of why all of us have to take intellectual property theft very seriously. This video is a video of some counterfeit airbags that we seized as part of a counterfeit airbag investigation. Airbags were counterfeit in China. They're every mark under the sun: European, American, German, Asian brand. So every automotive industry was targeted. This particular video involves a Honda airbag, but not singling Honda out in any way. GM, BMW, everybody was being counterfeit in the same way. And these counterfeit airbags were being manufactured overseas, sold aftermarket here in the United States, either through automotive repair shops or online. And almost impossible to tell from the outside the counterfeit from the original, because they're quite sophisticated in their packaging, but they're sold for much lower rates. And I'll let the video speak for itself, because what we did is we went and we had every single one of these counterfeit airbags tested by NHTSA. And there's the Highway Safety Administration here in the United States. All right, and let's show the folks what happened. All right. Every single one of these bags failed, and most of them exploded fairly dramatically when we tested them. They're not a single bag passed muster in any way. They were all catastrophic failures, and the individual, had they been driving at any speed, would have been killed or seriously injured. To those of you who would, sometimes suggest to us that, gee, you know, intellectual property enforcement's about some 15-year-old kid downloading, a song illegally over the internet. Nonsense. It's about that, and it's about public safety. It's about cancer medicines. It's, we just investigated a Canadian pharmacy online Canadian pharmacy. There was nothing Canadian about it. It was completely out of Eastern Europe, was a fraud from start to finish, and was run by organized crime. That's what we've got to deal with, and that's why we've got to cooperate together and work together. I'm so happy that we're doing exactly that. So with that, thank you for doing what you do, being willing to come here and listen to all of us, listen to me divert from my prepared remarks and go off on various tangents, and we'll see you soon. Thank you.
Thank you, John, and I think you raised a number of points that I hope we will also pick up in the panel discussion. Notably, if there are some lessons that can be learned from the child exploitation business and applied to the counterterrorism community as well, since President Clinton once said it's the economy stupid, but some could say it's the ideology stupid, and I think there are some lessons that can be applied in the counterterrorism domain as well. I might also note that when it comes to intellectual property, it's not only organized crime syndicates we're worrying about, sometimes it's nation states, and that gets to a very difficult set of issues where it's difficult to delineate between proxies that are perhaps used on behalf of nations and or organized crime syndicates, and that is one of the other reasons why I think when we're looking at the cyber domain in particular, we've got a whole lot of work to try to figure out who's behind that clickety-clack of the keyboard and get to the point where we can enhance our attribution capabilities. I'm dancing a teeny bit here because I understand our next speaker, Victoria Espinel, is coming from a White House meeting, should be arriving momentarily. Having been someone who worked at the White House, I know you can't say no to those meetings. So she's doing what her bosses expect her to do. But Patrick, do you feel we should... 30 seconds. But I do think when we're looking at the intellectual property sets of issues, it blurs very much with cyber, because cyber is the new means to be able to expand its reach. Okay, but sounds good. Let's take a very quick coffee break, not the full break, to let our keynote speaker get here and then proceed from there. Thank you. I told you I'm going to do this.
I
If I could please ask everyone to find their seats. Our last but not least keynote speaker has just arrived, Victoria Espinel, and as you find your seats, I'll quickly introduce her. Victoria was recently and unanimously confirmed by the Senate in 2009 as the first U.S. Intellectual Property Enforcement Coordinator. As many of you probably know, a strategy was recently released out of the White House that looked into some of the intellectual property enforcement issues, as well as some steps that the United States may consider taking in terms of enforcing theft along those lines. Victoria is, I think, at the heart of a very interesting set of issues that's got national security implications, it's got economic security implications, and it also has good old law enforcement and competitiveness sets of issues. I think she sits at the crossroads of what is going to be a growth industry, and I hope we're ready to take steps to continue to address these issues. Delighted you can make it. Understand, having worked in the White House myself, that those are meetings that are priority one, two, three, four, and five. But we're delighted you were able to take time out of what is undoubtedly an insane day to visit all of us. And there were a lot of discussions already touching on some of the intellectual property issues. So the floor is yours. Thank you, Victoria.
Well, hello, everyone. Thank you very much for having me here to speak with you. My name is Victoria Espinel, and I am the U.S. Intellectual Property Enforcement Coordinator at the White House. My role is a new one. This administration is the first one to have an Intellectual Property Enforcement Coordinator, and I was delighted, I'm very proud, to be nominated by President Obama to start the office. My job is to bring together all the different parts of the U.S. government, all the federal agencies, and the different offices at the White House, to make sure that we as an administration are protecting what Americans create and invent. This is President Obama and Vice President Biden are keenly aware that intellectual property enforcement is critical to the future of the U.S. economy. And so the issue of intellectual property and having a good and strong approach to intellectual property enforcement is one which has very high level and very deep support from the administration, from President Obama across the different federal agencies. Our relationship with Europe is, of course, also critical to the prosperity and the security of the United States. President Obama recently announced a transatlantic trade and investment partnership as one of the ways in which we want to further strengthen and deepen our relationship with Europe. U.S. Trade Representative Ron Kirk was also correct when he said that the great potential of a free trade agreement between the EU and the United States is that an agreement between us would strengthen not only ourselves but the global trading system as a whole. Cooperation on intellectual property enforcement is absolutely critical. Intellectual property enforcement is a global issue, and we will be much more effective if we are cooperating closely with each other. And this cooperation is possible and fruitful because we share many of the same priorities: supporting our workers, protecting our citizens from health and safety risks, promoting innovation and creativity, and ensuring that there is a fair trading environment where the rules are abided by and overseas markets are not polluted by infringing goods. One particular issue of concern for us, for the Obama administration at the moment, is the theft of trade secrets. This is when innovative trade secrets are being stolen from U.S. companies and they are being transferred overseas to foreign governments or foreign competitors to give them an unfair advantage. This is not behavior that can be tolerated. We will act aggressively to combat the theft of trade secrets, whether it is done by states themselves, those supported by state actors, or those that are acting for their own financial gain. My office recently released an administration strategy to mitigate the theft of trade secrets. Like our overall approach to intellectual property enforcement, we are taking a multi-pronged approach to combat the theft of trade secrets, including improved law enforcement and transatlantic cooperation. The trade secret strategy calls for consistent and sustained international engagement, the use of our trade tools, to reduce infringement and increase U.S. law enforcement. There are two components of the trade secret theft strategy that are particularly important to highlight today, and those are, first, that we call for increased law enforcement efforts by other countries to help stop trade secret theft and to prosecute those who commit trade secret theft. And second, we call for increased cooperation among countries that share our concerns about trade secret theft. And Europe is critical here. European companies are facing the same threats that our companies are facing, and we have to work together. That includes cooperating with respect to third countries where there are high incidents of trade secret theft. Happily, there is much good cooperation happening already in a variety of areas. We were very pleased that Europol joined the IPR Center as a full partner in 2012, and Europol has been a strong and effective partner with us on intellectual property enforcement. Our law enforcement agencies have worked closely with Europol on multilateral enforcement operations against websites that are selling counterfeit goods, including unsafe and counterfeit drugs. For instance, in Project Transatlantic, the IPR Center, together with Europol, seized 132 websites and made two arrests. Our law enforcement officials work closely with their European counterparts on a number of law enforcement operations. The amity that our two unions enjoy extends beyond platitudes and goes down to the brass tacks of police work. This is the best way to effectively combat transnational crime, and hardworking law enforcement professionals on both sides of the Atlantic are working to ensure that criminals are caught and that they are brought to justice. In this regard, I should commend the excellent work that is done by John Morton, who you just heard from, the director of ICE, and the IPR Center, which ICE hosts, but is not an ICE effort solely by any means. In fact, the whole point of the IPR Center, as you heard from John, as you'll hear from others today, is to bring together all the different federal law enforcement agencies to have them working together as effectively as possible. So, in a sense, my job, which is to bring together all the federal agencies and the White House offices to come up with a policy for intellectual property enforcement and to set the priorities of the administration, how we use our resources, the issues that we're going to tackle first. The IPR Center, in a sense, is a version of that for law enforcement. It brings together all the law enforcement agencies. It makes sure that cases are being deconflicted, that law enforcement agencies are pursuing the cases that are best suited to their mission. I will let others speak to the details of the IPR Center and the enforcement operations that it is engaged in, but I can tell you from where I sit, the IPR Center has been incredibly effective in bringing together the agencies. And what that means, the significance of that, is that we are seeing increased law enforcement. We are seeing increased law enforcement being done more efficiently. We are seeing it being the cases that are being tackled are more complicated and higher priority cases. And I think this is very important, we are seeing that being done with a relatively small, in fact, a very small increases in the resources that are used. So I think the effectiveness and the efficiency that the IPR Center has brought to our law enforcement operations is both incredibly important and incredibly commendable. And so I would take this opportunity to highlight the IPR Center and the approach that it has taken, and also to thank the dedication of DHS, including ICE and the Customs and Border Patrol and the Department of Justice, and the leadership that we have seen from those agencies over the last few years. A third area of cooperation that I want to highlight between the United States and Europe right now is trainings of enforcement and judicial officials. So just as one example, in the next few months, the IPR Center is going to lead a training at the International Law Enforcement Academy in Budapest and will be joined in that training by Europol. In addition, Europol and the IPR Center are going to host a forum later this month that is dedicated to health and safety issues, such as counterfeit airbags, which you heard about earlier, brake pads, and other items. It is cooperation such as this that provides justice to victims and saves innocent lives, regardless of nationality. ICE has also teamed up with OHIM, with the European Office of Harmonization of the Internal Market, to conduct trainings. And the purpose of those trainings is to lead to a better understanding of our enforcement processes and our overall approach to enforcement, and therefore to lead to more efficient, more comprehensive, and more dogged pursuit of criminals. It is clear that today we are seeing an increased information sharing and a generally receptive environment for transnational assistance. That is not coincidental, but is rather a concerted effort by both sides at good governance that only augments the already healthy relationship between the EU and the United States. In addition to cooperation between pan-European organizations like Europol and the US government, I want to mention the very important work that is happening between the law enforcement agencies of the member states of the European Union and the United States, including a robust law enforcement relationship with the UK and good and improving relationships with Italy, France, Sweden, Spain, and several Eastern European countries. In summary, I'm very optimistic about the future of multilateral assistance and cooperation between the United States and Europe. We have created an environment for further cooperation, and we are taking advantage of our shared ideology and history to root out those that engage in illicit transborder activity. Our open societies have produced immense advances in technology, innovation, human rights, and civil liberties, but also bear witness to crimes that take advantage of that openness. We refuse to accept that the dynamism which characterizes both the United States and Europe will be exploited for criminal gain, and we are doing and will continue to do all that we can in order to combat crime on both sides of the Atlantic. I want to thank all the law enforcement officers in the audience and around the world that have dedicated their professional lives to this endeavor. I look forward to working with you to continue to keep both the EU and the US economy safe from crime. And I speak for President Obama and for the entire administration when I say that we will continue to look for ways to leverage our general accord with Europe into better cooperation and better enforcement. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Victoria. And thank you for a comprehensive discussion on a set of issues that, again, we're going to raise in the panel discussion. What I'm going to do is take the prerogative of the moderator's chair, say that we're going to take a very, very short break, if we can, and go right into the panel conversation. So maybe a five-minute break. Let me, before we escape in the public session, thank Patrick Byrne, who put this together. I mean, he brought together the who's who of the community. And for the panel discussion, get ready for the hard questions. So I think there's a lot to cover, a lot to address, and looking forward to that. So 5 minute break, come back. Thanks.